references that Paul makes to, makes as my gospel. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 11, he also references that, and then again in 2 Timothy chapter 2. And there are actually several references, but these are just two to give you a, just to give you a sample of Paul's use of my gospel and the gospel that was given to me. Now, what was Paul's gospel? We know, of course, that Paul received the revelation of the gospel of grace. In a nutshell, we could say the gospel of grace. In fact, on your outline, I think I may have given you a yes. Paul spoke of my gospel, and the gospel was given to me. What was Paul's gospel? In a nutshell, it was the gospel of grace. But now let's look at some specific points, and this is not an exhaustive list. This is just to give you, just to kind of skim the surface here. First of all, that Jesus is the Christ who died for our sins. He was buried and raised on the third day. Now, where can we find that in Scripture, in Paul's writings? And we looked at that Scripture last Sunday. We looked at it several times before. Where is that reference where Paul says that his gospel was that Christ died, was buried, and rose again on the third day? Where is that located? Yes, 1 Corinthians 15. Good, somebody had it. Let's turn over there to 1 Corinthians 15. You see, you need to know this, okay? This will be on the test. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. I believe in apologetics. Being able to defend the faith. We need to know what we believe and why we believe. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. Paul said, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." And then he goes on into those who were witnesses of the resurrection of Jesus. So first point, Jesus is the Christ who died for our sins. He was buried and raised on the third day. And then the second point, redemption through the blood of Jesus, which provides forgiveness of sins. Redemption through the blood of Jesus. Go on over to Ephesians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians. Ephesians 1, 7. By the way, we get into our study of Paul and his, what was his gospel. As we look more in depth in that, starting in 2 weeks, I would want us to go to Paul's letters, particularly Galatians and Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. This is one of those verses you should have committed to memory. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. Now going over to chapter 2, the third point. Justification is by grace or faith alone, apart from the works of the law. Ephesians 2, 8. Now, I know you're sitting here saying, "Barbara, we know all of this. This is primer stuff." Well, I hope that we all do know this. But I'm laying a foundation here for some conflict that's going to arise to Paul's message. Ephesians 2:8. "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. For by grace are you saved through faith." So justification is by grace alone. And then the fourth point, the church composed of Jew and Gentile is the body of Christ. See, all of this was a revelation to Paul. This was the gospel that was given to Paul when he was in the desert of Arabia for those 3 years. After Paul was converted, he's kind of jumping ahead of himself here. Paul was converted on the road to Damascus. He did not go back to Jerusalem and confer with Peter and the other apostles and like, okay. do that. In fact, he says in, the, in his letter to the church of Galatia, I did not confer with the leaders at Jerusalem. But instead, he went to, he went into the desert, and there he spent 3 years along with the Lord, where God gave him this revelation. And indeed, it was a revelation. We're going to go back to the book of Acts and see how this, this actually made headline news. Ephesians 2:16. Now, the church is composed of Jew and Gentile, and it is the body of Christ. 2:16. And that he might reconcile both, could say in parentheses, Jew and Gentile, unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereof. Now, I say that Paul received the revelation of the church as composed of Jew and Gentile, and the church as the body of Christ. Now, this concept of the church had actually been given before Paul, but not in its fullness. You see, God had not yet given that revelation of the plan and the purpose for the church. God had not yet revealed the fullness of his plan of salvation and redemption through grace, justification by faith, and forgiveness of sin, all apart from the works of the law. That had not yet been given. However, this concept of church, and this is so important. This concept of church had all, the church, the body, had already been established, because even Jesus in Matthew chapter 16, you know, when Jesus said to Peter, whom do men say that I am? And what did Peter say? Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, flesh and blood is not revealed unto you, but my Father who is in heaven. And Jesus said, upon this rock, in other words, upon this foundation, that I am the Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I guess the disciples, Peter and the others who were standing there, they probably scratched their heads like, now what does that mean? You know, there was one occasion where Jesus gave some revelation, and he said to the disciples, do you understand what I've said? And you know what they did? They said, yes. They didn't have a clue. You want to say, oh, why didn't they say, no, Jesus, give us more detail. So, this concept of the church had already been given. And in Acts chapter 2, after the day of Pentecost, the Lord added to the church such as should be saved. In Acts chapter 5, after Ananias and Sapphira were struck dead in church. Great fear came upon the church. And even Paul said, Paul admitted before his conversion, he said, I persecuted the church of God. So you see, this concept of the church had already been given. Now, why am I making such a big deal about this? I know we're all sitting here thinking, yeah, we get it. There is a movement, and I've actually encountered this movement. There is a movement that says the church was not born on the day of Pentecost. The church was not born until Paul received the revelation. The church was born on the day of Pentecost. Now, granted, as we look at what Peter and the apostles were preaching, you can tell that they don't have the revelation. The revelation of the fullness of God's plan and purpose for the church was not given. It didn't come into focus until Paul received it. So we're going to look at what were Peter and the other apostles preaching and teaching before Paul's revelation. It's still the church in its infancy. The church was born on the day of Pentecost. Granted, for that first few years, it was in its infancy. Now, let's review one more time. What was Paul's gospel in a nutshell? It was the gospel of grace. Number one, Jesus died for our sins. He was buried and raised on the third day. Jesus, and are saved by grace. So, what did Peter and the other apostles preach and teach before Paul's revelation? And how was Paul's message received by Peter and the apostles? Because Peter's revelation was radically different. It was radically new. So, what was the message of Peter and the 12 and the others following Acts chapter 2, but yet before Paul's revelation of saved by grace apart from works? First of all, I'm going to give you the 3 points, and then we're going to look at some of Peter's preaching and his sermons. First of all, in Roman numeral 3 on your outline, repentance for rejecting and murdering the Messiah. Repentance for rejecting and murdering the Messiah. In our study that we're going to do, we're going to go back to Jesus' ministry, Matthew chapter 12, where Jesus was formally rejected by the religious leaders of Israel. That was his official rejection. God pronounced judgment upon Israel. He said, your house is left unto you desolate. So Peter is preaching repentance for rejecting and murdering the Messiah Jesus. Secondly, salvation based on believing that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. Salvation based on believing that Jesus is the Messiah. You see, Peter is just preaching what Jesus said was the rock upon which the church would be built. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's what Peter does to preach. Their preaching continued to be directed to the Jews. You see, I think we have this tendency to think that on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was poured out, the church was Jesus had said, you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and other parts of the earth. We think that immediately Peter and the other apostles went out and started preaching justification by faith, apart from the works of the law. We are saved through the blood of Jesus. We have forgiveness of sins. We are now all part of the body of Christ. No, they did not. They did not have that revelation. Now, are we to fault them for that? Absolutely not, because as I said, God had not yet given the fullness of his plan for the purpose, the plan and the purpose of the church. We're still in the infancy stage. Now, let's look at, now I've given you those 3 points of what Peter and the other apostles were preaching before Paul's revelation. Let's go, we're going to look at several scriptures here in Acts. Go back to Acts chapter 2. This is on the day of Pentecost now. 2:22. And I want you to keep in mind now those points that I've just given to you. What is Paul, Peter preaching? Repent for rejecting and murdering the Messiah. Salvation based on belief that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. And they're preaching what's just to the Jews. Acts 2, verse 22. This is on the day of Pentecost. Peter stood up to preach. 2:22. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as you yourselves also know. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain. Now, that's going to be a theme until Paul's revelation. Peter and the apostles, every chance they get to preach, they're going to point their finger and say, your wicked hands have slain the Messiah. You must repent for that sin of rejecting the Messiah and for murdering him. Verse 24, Peter goes on. Whom God has raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it Now, drop down to verse 32. He goes on then there into David, and I'm going to skip that portion. Let's go on to verse 32. This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Now, you see, he is preaching the resurrection. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this which you now see and hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, the Lord said to my Lord, sit thou on my right hand until I make thy foes thy footstool. Verse 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly. The house of Israel. You see, he's directing his gospel, his preaching to whom? To the Jews, to Israel, yes. Know assuredly. Why? Let me pause there. So why are they just preaching to the Jews and to Israel? Why are they directing their preaching just to them? Because in Jesus' ministry, what had Jesus said? I have been sent to the lost house of Israel. Yes. And he said, go and just preach to the Jews. Jesus in his earthly ministry. Now, see, that's all they know up to this point. Even though Jesus has said, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, you'll be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. Those are all three areas of the Jews. Of course, the Samaritans were a mixed race, Jews, even. And then the uttermost parts of the earth. Who's going to take it to the uttermost parts of the earth? Paul. Paul is called to be the apostle to the Gentiles. That's right. Thank you, Jesus. That's us. Yes. Now, I know like, you all are sitting there looking at me like, okay, so what's this got to do with anything? This is important, okay? I think sometimes we assume things. This has happened to me. You know, I assume this and I assume that from the Word. But when we begin to dig into the Word, sometimes it shocks our theology.
Well, yes, in other words, the Gentiles can only see what Peter did because it didn't mean anything.
Right, it didn't. Exactly. Yes. So he's still directing this to the Jews because he's still of that mindset of what Jesus had said when Jesus was on earth. I've been sent to the lost house of Israel. I've been sent to the Jews. Why was that? Why did Jesus say, just go to the Jews? This was to fulfill the covenant that God had made with Abraham. To fulfill the covenant. Touch on a lot of things. I'm probably going to leave you with more questions today than I am answered. We're going to come back in 2 weeks. We're going to go back to the beginning and work our way up to this, okay? So if you leave here today and scratch your head and say, now what did she say? We'll come back in 2 weeks and we'll look more carefully at things, but I'm just going to throw a lot at you today. Verse 36, let's pick up that again. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. See, he's still doing that with an accusing tone. Bad people, you crucified the Son of God. Oh, but that was all in part of God's plan, wasn't it? That was God's plan. And Paul's going to come along saying, don't feel condemned because you did that. That was part of God's plan. Because it's through Jesus and his offering on the cross that we are saved. We have forgiveness of sins. We're no longer bound to the law. I tell you, when Paul comes on the scene, he is going to create a splash. I don't think we comprehend how big a splash Paul is going to make when he comes up with this radical revelation. In fact, it's so radical that there is a council that is called in Jerusalem and said, we got to discuss this. we, let's get this, let's lay all the cards on the table. What about this message that Paul is preaching, this unique message that he is preaching? Oh, it just gives me chills to think. Aren't you thankful this morning that God gave Paul a revelation of the cross and its power, that we have forgiveness of sins, and at the council in Jerusalem, Peter is the one who stood up and said, we cannot put this yoke of the law on the Gentiles. You see, that's what it boiled down to. Some of the Jews were saying, these Gentiles who were getting saved now in Paul's ministry, they've got to be baptized into Judaism. They've got to be circumcised. And they've got to embrace Judaism. And Paul is saying, no, 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 no. No law, no Judaism for the Gentiles. We are no longer under the law. Oh, and he wrote his letter to the church at Rome to explain that. Oh, this morning just makes me want to do a cheating. Watch out. Let's go on here. Now, verse 37. Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Now, repent for what? Repent for being part of this generation that has rejected and crucified Jesus. That's actually what Peter is saying. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Who has another translation besides, I have King James. Who has another translation? What are the New King James? Ronnie, you have New King James? How is that phrased in verse 40? This perverse generation, yes. Okay, King James says untoward. Is there anybody's translation that says that uses a different word there? This corrupt generation. Okay, corrupt. Okay. So what generation is? Why? That seems like a very strange thing for you to say. When Jesus was formally rejected in Matthew chapter 12. You know, when the religious leader, he performed a miracle, and the religious leader said, he's doing this because he is what? Yes, and he's possessed of the devil. That was the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit right there, attributing the works of God to the devil. And Jesus, from that point, he begins to talk about this generation. This generation has come under judgment. This generation. And that's why Peter is saying, save yourselves from this generation. Because Jesus said to this, and we're going to go back and we'll look in Matthew. You get a chance as we read Matthew 12, 13, along in there. Jesus talks about this generation who rejected him as Messiah and who accused him and say he is demon-possessed. And he says, this house is left unto you desolate. Judgment. And you know, Jesus went up on the Mount of Olives, and he looked over Jerusalem, and he said, judgment is coming to Jerusalem. And what did Jesus do on the Mount of Olives? He wept. Because he saw the destruction that was coming upon them because they had rejected him as Messiah. He said to the Jews, you did not recognize the day of your visitation. The day of your visitation of the Messiah. And I want to say to you, how missed it? Why were your eyes so blinded? Daniel had prophesied of the coming of the Messiah, I mean down to the exact day when Jesus would ride into Jerusalem on the donkey and he would be a proclaimed that adulation. He would be acclaimed as the Messiah. Jesus said, you missed the day of your visitation. All folks, you still miss the day of visitation. And Jesus pronounced judgment upon them, which came in 70 A.D. when the Romans surrounded Jerusalem and literally starved it out. Over a million people, a million Jews died in that siege. Many of them from starvation. The Romans just camped around the city of Jerusalem and said, we'll starve them out. They sat there, The Jews who had fled into the old city of Jerusalem there at the temple because they felt like they would be safe there. They were like trapped rats. They literally were starved. And then the Romans set fire to the city. And that's why Peter is preaching here saying, repent of this sin of rejecting the Messiah and separate yourselves from this corrupt generation, because devastation, destruction, and judgment is coming upon this generation. So separate yourselves. And he says, be baptized. And there's so much more meaning in that Jewish concept of baptism. Then now, of course, we're baptized after we're saved, and then we follow the Lord in baptism. And that is merely that does not bring us salvation. Baptism does not save us, but it identifies us with the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. It identifies us with Jesus. And so Peter is saying, repent of this sin. Separate yourself from this generation that judgment is coming upon. Be baptized, and that will set you apart from that generation that's going to bring destruction. So you see, that is Peter's message. God was being merciful to these Jews who would recognize the sin that had been committed by, and we can say by their leaders, but the people followed their leaders. All right, let's go on to chapter 3. Chapter 3, verse 11. This is following the healing of the lame man. Verse 3:11, and as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto him in the porch that was called Solomon, greatly wondering. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel you at this, and why look you so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers. So you see, he's still identifying with the Abrahamic covenant. That's the most important covenant to the Jews. He's still identifying with that. The God of our fathers hath glorified his son Jesus, whom you delivered up. There he is again. And denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But you denied the Holy One and the Just One and desired a murderer to be granted to you. And you killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are all witnesses. He goes on to say, and through faith in his name. Now drop down to verse 25 of that same chapter. You are the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. See, he's still taking them back to the covenant with Abraham. Unto you first, God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you and turn away every one of you from his iniquities. Now, for the sake of time, we're not going to look at all of the other scriptures. In every chapter, there's preaching. And it's along this same line, but you get the idea. Let's look at Stephen's sermon right here before we move on here. And chapter 7, look at verse 51. This is Stephen's sermon. Stephen, of course, was stoned. He was so martyr of the faith, and he's preaching to them. This is right before the stone. Chapter 7, verse 51, he says, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised and hardened ears, you do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so are you. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted, and they have slain them which showed before the coming of the Just One, of whom you have now been the betrayers and the murderers?" See, Stephen is still preaching along that same line. Now, we'll come back and examine these more closely in the coming weeks. Turn it over to chapter 9 now. We work our way into chapter 9, and it is here, of course, where Paul is on his way to Damascus there with the written orders that he in authorizing him to haul Christians into jail and throw them into prison to persecute them, and that's what Saul here in this chapter. And then, of course, we know about his conversion. Paul is converted, goes to Damascus, he goes into a house on a straight street. God sends Ananias and says, "Go and lay hands on Saul, and that because I have called him to the Gentiles, and he will suffer much for the gospel." Saul is recovered. He immediately goes out and starts preaching, and guess what he preaches? Look at 9:20. "And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogue that he is the Son of God." So you see, his preaching is not really any different here, right here at the initial, right here at the very beginning of Peter and the other apostles. But let's read on down, because it is at between verses 25 and 26, there's a gap there, and that's where Paul goes into the desert of Arabia. It's just on verse 21, for chapter 9. "But all that heard him were amazed and said, is not this he that destroyed them which called on his name in Jerusalem, and came hither for that intent that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. And after many days were fulfilled, the Jews took counsel to kill him. But they're laying away his number of Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night and led him down by the wall in a basket." So he escapes the city. Now, it's generally thought that right here between verses 25 and 26 is where we have that gap where Paul escaped, and he did go to Arabia for those 3 years. And we're going to look at Galatia, because you can see in verse 26, "And when Saul was come to Jerusalem," indeed, after he had spent that time in Arabia, actually a few years passed, he did go back to Jerusalem. Now, flip back over to Acts chapter 3. One other thing I want to make about Paul and the other apostles. Even though they have not, God has not yet given this revelation of the doctrine of the church, and for by grace are you saved through faith, and in whom we have redemption through his blood, justification by faith apart from works. Even though that revelation has not yet been given at this point that we're looking at right here, right after the day of Pentecost, were those apostles, Peter and the others, were they saved? As we know in that concept of saved, yes, they were. They were. They just, because you see, they're preaching Jesus the Son of God, and he was resurrected. And you know what Paul said in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. They were indeed saved. They just don't have that full revelation as yet, but it's coming. God is going to give that, he's going to lay out that plan and purpose, his plan and purpose that has been kept secret. It's been the mystery, that's what Paul calls it. Now, one other point I want to make about Peter and the others here, hold of this revelation that Paul has. They are still practicing Judaism. Surprise, surprise. They are still clinging to their Judaism. Look in chapter 3, verse 1. Keep in mind that Pentecost was in chapter 2. Chapter 3, verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. The ninth hour is the hour of prayer at the temple. You see, they're still being faithful to the temple. Is that, should we fault them for that? No, because God has not said, do not go back to the temple. God hasn't said that. Flip over to chapter 10. Now, this is, of course, this is the chapter where Peter goes to Cornelius. Cornelius is indeed a Gentile. Talk more about that in the coming weeks as well. Now, Peter is up on the rooftop, and he has this vision. Look in verse, let's start verse 10. And Peter became very hungry and would have eaten, but while they made ready, he fell into a trance and saw heaven open and a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners and let down to the earth, wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, and wild beasts, and creeping things, and fowls of the air. There came a voice to him, rise, Peter, kill and eat. Now you see those animals that he saw in the sheep, those were unclean, according to the dietary laws of the law of Moses. The Jews did not touch these unclean animals. And look what Peter says in verse 14. But Peter said, not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that's common or unclean. Now, granted, what's the Lord revealing here to Peter? The Gentiles have been known as dogs and unclean. Yes, and the Lord's about to teach Peter a lesson. It's not about food. It's about taking the gospel to these dogs, the Gentiles. Because Peter's about to have an opportunity to go to the home of a Gentile. Jews did not go into the homes of the Gentiles. So, you see, but you can see how Peter's still clinging to Judaism because he said, ooh, those are unclean animals. Lord, you know, I've never eaten anything unclean. Now, when he begins to get hold here of what the Lord's teaching him, and he goes to the home of Cornelius, and look what he says to Cornelius when he gets there. Verse 28. Peter said unto them, you know that it is an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or to come unto one of another nation. See, he's still clinging to that Judaism. We're not supposed to go into a Gentile home because then that makes us unclean. But he goes on to say, but God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore, I have come to you as soon as I was sent. Now, let's jump over to Paul. Paul in chapter 9, he has to flee from Damascus, and he goes to the desert. Turn over to Galatians chapter 1. I'm going to wrap this up briefly. Galatians chapter 1. He writes to them and tells them about this experience of being in the desert alone with the Lord. God lays out this wonderful plan of salvation. Galatians 1:11. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jewish religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. So he was a superior Jew. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, in other words, Gentiles. Immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. Then after 3 years I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter, and abode with him 15 days. But other of the apostles saw I none, save James the Lord's brother. Now go over to chapter 2, verse 22. Then 14 years after I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, and took Titus with me also, and I went up by revelation and communicated unto them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to them which were of reputation, lest by any means I should run or have run. So, you see, he's telling about how he received this revelation of this glorious plan that God had through the centuries, since the foundation of the world, for the salvation of man, that it had been kept secret. And Paul says, God has laid that out to me. Now, let's quickly go back to Acts chapter 15, and I'll have to wrap this up. I'm rushing over this, but we'll come back to this. Now, on your outline, number 4, Romans 4. After Paul's conversion, he went to the desert of Arabia, and it's there that God revealed his plan of salvation apart from works. Also his plan and purpose for the church as the body of Christ. Romans 5. The Jerusalem Council was called to consider 3 issues. Do Gentiles have to be circumcised according to the law of Moses? Do Gentiles have to first be baptized into Judaism in order to be saved? And number 3, what about this gospel of grace that Paul is preaching? Let's see what the council decided. I hope you'll read this entire chapter sometime this week. I'm just going to hone in on starting at verse 7. And you'll notice that James, the half-brother of Jesus, is presiding over this council meeting. It is not Peter. Peter is fading away. Peter's ministry is fading away. In fact, after 1522, we don't hear Peter anymore in the book of 1522, who is the book of Acts focusing upon? Paul. Peter has been the main man up until about chapter 12, but now his ministry is fading. Should we feel sorry for Peter? No, because that's God's plan. God is just moving them off the stage, and he's saying, here's the revelation. This is it. This is what I've been. This is what we've been focused. This is what God is saying. This is what I've been heading you toward. Oh, hallelujah. I've got chill bumps. I don't know about y'all. Verse 7, we're in chapter 15. And when there had been much disputing, look who rose up. Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, you know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth, he's talking about when he went to Cornelius' house, should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bare them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost even as he did to us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now, why tempt ye God to put the yoke, he's talking about the yoke of the law, don't put this yoke of the law upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear. He's saying, don't put this yoke of the law of Moses on the Gentiles. Because Peter, you see, it's almost like this is a cliffhanger. How is Peter going to respond to Paul's message of, we're saved apart from the law? Because Peter's been clinging to the law. He's been hanging on to the law because he didn't know any better. So, does he stand up and dispute and say, we got to throw that heretic Paul out here? No. Oh, I just admire Peter so much. Peter stood up and said, let's don't put that yoke of the law on our Gentile brothers, because even we ourselves and our fathers could not fulfill that law. And look what he says in verse 11. But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved, even as they. Peter says that message that Paul has received, saved by grace through faith, he said, that's what we've been waiting for. Oh, can you just say yes? Oh, good for you, Peter. You know what would have happened if Peter had stood up and said, that is heresy, let's throw them all out. You know what would have happened? It would have been disastrous. It would have been disastrous. Peter saw the handwriting on the wall and he could see that. Oh, hallelujah. What a great note to end on. Okay, now let's stop here. I hope we will be back next Sunday and Faith will be sharing with us, and that will be a blessing here. 2 weeks we'll be back and we'll pick up and see what happened with Paul. We're going to go back to the ministry of Jesus and this thing about judgment coming upon this generation. And I'll go back and fill in the gaps, okay? I know I've left a lot of gaps for today. Thank you so much for being here today. Debbie?
One notebook,
all right. If you get an outline every Sunday, and it's good for you to save those outlines, to go back and review that later. And we have these beautiful folders here. They're free. We have one left. If you would like to have one to keep your outlines in every Sunday, you are welcome to this one. Okay? I'm going to put it right here on the front. So please come up here and get this, okay? All right, let's have a word of prayer in closing. Father, we just thank you. Lord, my heart is so full today. Oh, how we praise you for that revelation that you have given, that we are saved by grace through faith. It is not by the works of the law, which no man can keep. Lord, today we stand righteous before you because of what Jesus accomplished for us upon the cross. Jesus, we give you praise today. We give you glory for your sacrifice upon the cross. Not only your sacrifice, but that you were raised on the third day, and that because you live, we shall live also. And we just bless the wonderful name of Jesus.
I Hey, listen, you're just a small dog.
You got a small dog. Is that running great?
Thank you.